That's quite a couple of years ago.
And what sort of music were you doing back then?
It was, you can imagine, a little bit like Tears for Fears, a little bit like that. Unfortunately, at that time, it was just the time of the boy groups coming up. So the record label then asked us to do some dance routines and stuff. And then we thought, nah, that's probably not good for us. And luckily enough.
We tried.
Yeah,
but it didn't work.
No, it didn't really work, no. And then luckily enough, it was just about the time, early 90s when techno came up. And we realized that this is actually a really good thing because you don't have to go on a stage. You can be in the studio all day long and just produce records and just release them on all the record labels. And that's exactly what we did for many, many years to go, on the Hard House labels or on R&S was our first release. A track called Una Musica Senza Ritmo. That was very, very good for us as producers because we loved electronic music. We fell in love with techno, very new at that time, very exciting. New records, groundbreaking records coming out every week, basically. And that was a lot of fun.
And I remember, not very far away from here, there used to be a record shop called Know How Records in Camden where I used to buy my vinyl. And I started buying this label that would have a purple or a yellow sleeve, sort of electro-tinged tracks by people like DJ T. And this became my favourite label in about 2002. It was, of course, Get Physical. Which you guys started. Why did you want to start your own label back then?
Very simple reason. Nobody wanted to release our music. So they all passed. In the end, they bite their own asses afterwards, probably, because it was very successful. So, but at that time, we produced music that probably, it was different to that, what you've heard in the clubs. It was the time of Schranz. You remember Schranz? Schranz was a very hard techno. Even Sven Fed, he played minimal in Schranz. And so we came back with our melody bass lines. And it seems it was exactly the right moment for it. So, and it was very successful. And it was, for us, it was, we were struggling all the time because the office was my bedroom and a little table like this size here. And this was the office. And then suddenly all the success came in worldwide. And it was like, there were simple questions. Who buys the next fax paper? You know, at that time there was still fax. Who's communicating to the people? We had a lot of things to learn at that time. We had no clue about record label management.
No business plan.
No.
But you learned pretty quickly, I imagine.
6 years, shortly before we left.
And then this record came along.
That was 2005. It was a sunny day. and I thought, this is the day. Not at all. They had to convince us to release that as a single. It was actually just a track for a compilation of Get Physical called Body Language. And the DJs came back and said, listen, you have to see what's happening when we play that song. Mm-hmm. And we said, it's just the B-side, we just did it. And so then I think it was a Miami music conference or so where we found out that that the song is quite famous. And then we said, okay, we should release it as a 12-inch and do it proper. And so it took a long time until the song became so famous. I'm pretty sure that nowadays it wouldn't be possible to have a success like that with a song like that. Two summers. And then came Will I Am, did a versions for America, so it became bigger and bigger and bigger.
And of course, we
always played it and tried to promote it and did new versions. And it, of course, then it was a crowd pleaser from the first second on. And that's how it worked.
Where did that bass line come from?
From a keyboard. An electronic keyboard. No, it's just actually many people ask me. I don't know. There was a track that we worked on for a long time, but we weren't happy with it. And the guys left the room, and suddenly I played the bass line. I don't know. It just. As I said, I had no clue that it's a bass line that attracts so many people. I had absolutely no clue. I just, okay, I have a bass line. This is the song. Go away. That was my plan. And they went away. And sometimes you need luck.
Of led to it. So there was a the bass line was different. Yeah, the bass line was different in the beginning, so there were different versions because, you know, the whole vibe around that time with Get Physical and with Mandy and DJ T, it was just all these, you know, guys like in the kindergarten or so, you know, that we all hung together and there was a certain atmosphere. And out of this atmosphere and attitude came this music. And when we did the Movement Stand re-release, we tried to look for early versions. So there were, the groove was very different and there was kind of the sound of the bass line, but it was different. And then all of a sudden, it was just there.
I guess Body Language and subsequent releases launched your career, and you went on to produce albums, do big gigs. why have you ended up preferring to play live rather than DJ?
You rather DJ?
No, not DJ. I'm rather in the studio. Sorry.
Okay. I'm not. I'm against it. Whatever you say, I'm against it. What?
Doesn't matter what you say.
What did you say? No. The answer is always no. No, well, we're musicians. We're musicians. The story was that the Mandy guys, very close friends of ours, they always came back from the weekends when they started to DJ. And this, as Walter said, you should hear how the people react to your music. You should do this. And but we said, well, we're not DJs. We're musicians. So what can we do? And Walter is a keyboard player. I'm a drummer. So that wasn't a big idea. We do something with keyboards and drums, obviously. And it was kind of a novelty in the club surrounding because nobody was so crazy to take all this equipment to a club, set it up somewhere in a corner and perform live music in a DJ surrounding. They all said, nowadays, of course, it's USB sticks. In the old days, it was a vinyl still or a CD. And they said, no, I only need this. I don't need all this equipment. But we prefer to do the live show. And it's something that we're good at, we believe. And you should always do what you're best at. We did some DJing in between because after a certain album, I think it was in 2008, we were trying to for something new and we wanted also new inspiration. So we tried it out for a couple of years. It's, you know, it can be good fun, but at the end of the day, you know, we're songwriters, we're producers, we want to do this on a live stage.
Cool. Why did you guys step away from Get Physical in the end?
I think the main reason was that there were too many people just involved, you know, and six artists, creative artists, doing a label together that doesn't work. So, and in the end, it was like we did a lot of money with it because it was really successful, and all the money went into parties, you know. So the parties were bigger and bigger. But in the end, we decided that we want to leave and do our own stuff. But we have no stress or anything. Mm-hmm. So the Mandy guys, they are still involved in Get Physical. They own now the label. So it's fine for us. So we just said, in the end, we just started to do Book of Shape because we wanted to get out of the business. We did 15 years of commercial music. So we were like chart producers for 15 years. It's a very heavy job, and it's 16 hours a day, and it's like we were more or less burned out. And then suddenly, we just did out of a hobby with these records, and sold 100,000 vinyls alone from Movement's album. So we said, okay, it's two super crazy figures nowadays. But and then we had the same problem paragraphs that we had to find employees, and suddenly we had a 400 square meter office, 35 people. And I remember I went in the elevator to go to the office, and there was a girl, and she said, hey, you're Walter from Bugeshed. I said, yes, yeah. And she said, oh yeah, I work for you. Oh, you just started. No, it was since 5 months. And I said, okay, good, so I think I should do something else. It was too much, you know? Yeah. No, but we are still good friends.
Oh, cool.
With the girl in the elevator.
Yes.
All right.
My wife, we have three.
Okay. We can cut this out afterwards, right?
So you mentioned the Movements album, and you revisited that last year, didn't you, to kind of bookend that chapter in your career. Now, what was the thinking behind the new album, Galvany Street, when you were thinking, oh, we're going to do a new album now? What were you thinking?
I'm glad you asked this question. yeah, the As you can probably already, as you understand already, every couple of years we look for something else, obviously, in our lives. Since the very beginning with this Planet Claire thing, the first underground wave, then other production, then get physical. Also the DJing in between, I would say, applies to this, because as an artist, you always want to try out new things, at least we do. We had the feeling that, especially with the re-release of Movements, we could close a chapter in a way. And we just realized, because we worked on the new album already for a year and a half or so, and then the Movements idea came along, and we realized, okay, we want to try something else with music and not repeat ourselves. It's something we don't like to do. We did a lot with the riffs and the bass lines, and the you know, techno and tech house beats, but at the moment for quite a while already, we felt, you know, we want to do something else. We want to take the disco beats. It's not that we say goodbye to dance music, but the new album is much more about disco beats than tech house beats. And also on the albums, on previous albums, we always had the slower tracks anyway. So we wanted something that worked together really nicely. And also we wanted vocals. So we came to the point where we said, okay, good, let's take this Movements 10 concept, close a chapter and open a new chapter and just do something else. And then here comes your thing here. And then we bumped into Craig, because we had tried out a couple of vocalists already for a year and a half or so. And we didn't have the feeling that it worked really well for us. And then a year and a half ago, Craig just moved from Dublin to Berlin, and he happened to take a studio in the same studio complex where I am. It's called Riverside in Kreuzberg, Berlin. And we got introduced, and not a big plan, but we said, okay, why, you know, Walter and I, we have a backing track, why don't you try something out? And he came up with something we really enjoyed, and we had the feeling, this is quite interesting. So we tried another one and another one. And then after a while we had, there are 7 songs on the album, but there are more songs, of course. And we felt, I think this could be an album.
Craig, let's bring you in here. What sort of things had you done before moving to Berlin?
I was in a band called Power of Dreams when I was a teenager, and did 4 albums with them. I was in a band called Archive after that, from London. I lived in London for like 15 years, and during that period I worked with Archive, did 4 albums with them. Is it still working?
Hello.
And then I started writing for other people, and I had a big hit recently with Fade Out Lines, you know, that song that was I don't know whether it was a hit in the UK, but it was number one all over the place. And off the back of that, I signed to a German publisher, and hence I moved to Berlin. The publisher suggested me being there. I went with the intention to write, just to be a writer. I didn't expect to be doing any of this ever again.
So what did you think when these two guys said, oh, come do a track with us?
I was really up for it. I just moved to Berlin, and I was kind of, you know, I was really excited, and I'd moved into a new studio, and I was surrounded by a lot of like techno DJs. Riverside is quite predominantly techno. It's run by one of the guys from Pampot. So there was that going on, and I Martin, the owner, had said to me that I should meet the guys, because we'd have a lot of, like, we're similar age, we have similar kind of backgrounds. And he felt that we'd have something in common, and I met the guys, and we just had a chat, and just didn't know what was going to happen, and then they started sending me tracks, and it started to work. I'd no idea whether it was going to work, whether they'd like what I did, because I knew the band, and I knew that it was quite up, and I was coming in with my kind of darker lyrics, and they that's what they wanted. And it was interesting, because when I'd put a vocal on a track that they gave me, I'd give them the vocal, they'd go away, they'd be off on tour. It was around the time of the Movements tour, and they were coming back and forward. And I'd go and see them in the studio, and they'd play me, they'd say, oh, we've got something for that track. And I'd go in, and it'd be a totally new backing track, completely different. And the vocals would be used in, like, what I thought was the chorus was now the verse, and all that kind of stuff. So it was really it was interesting for me because I was going in to listen to a song that I'd sung but didn't know it. And
so it's not so you'd originally get a kind of a track and you'd write to it, but then it would be
they'd
all
change it. But the original tracks are always brilliant. That's the thing about the guys. I mean, they're great producers. They were the best demos I've ever heard in my life. You know, and they didn't end up getting used. So the level was really high. It was really easy to write to because the music's extremely melodic. And but the change in the music thing was quite weird at first. You know, and Walter would say it's totally different, and he didn't lie. So it was always surprising for me, which was nice.
There's a couple of other vocalists on the album as well, isn't there? Tell us a little bit about those.
Yeah, so there is. What is wrong with this microphone? Your voice sounds always so good. Is there a knob that you have? No, you have a trick here. You press something and then you have this like.
I have the stuff.
Yeah, no. I don't. Whatever. I hate him. So yeah. No, there are other vocalists on the album. There's Yates from Australia, very cool singer. He lives in Berlin at the moment, yeah. Then there's a guy from London called Daniel Spencer, young kid, I can say, right?
Yep.
He sings on Broken Skin. So, and this came via our management, and this is the only guy we didn't have in the studio, was Daniel Spencer. So we just like sent the files back and forth. But with Yates, we were in the studio. And we didn't want to have too many different vocals on the album because it always sounds like a compilation when you have 10 different singers on an album. So it was important that we have more or less the same color of voices on the album. So, and they fit quite nicely into the rest. So that's why we said, well, now we have an album together. So we didn't have a deadline this time. We didn't book the tour or anything. We just said the album's finished when it's finished. And we had an album finished 1.5 years ago, but it was more like into this tech house, techno, melodic, dance world. And then we said, no, that's not, no. This time we have to do it. There is no way around it. So, and then we put this aside, met him, and started fresh again. And suddenly we had 7 songs together, and then we had another 2, and then we counted it together, and we were 9, and then we said, we need a little instrumental, 10. Wow, we have an album. That's how it is. So it's really, this is a story. And then we asked him if he's up for going on tour with us, and he said yes. So, and we didn't have any pressure this time. That was pretty cool. That's why these 3.5 years production time didn't feel like 3.5 years.
Why is it called Galvany Street?
This is your story, because you are more into chemical stuff.
Yes, the chemicals. No, we were very creative because we all know that in school, the galvanic process, you can tell me about it, but I will tell it for you. Yeah, it's. I looked it up also. It's chemical energy is turned into electrical energy. And so then we said, the chemical energies, that's Bouchershade and Craig Walker, and the electrical is then the music. Also, it sounds very good. So,
and some of it sounds quite sort of 90s, which has been said by a few people I think who've heard it.
Who lived then?
Who lived through that time? Mm. Are you happy with the way it's come out?
Yeah, some of the 90s. Well, yeah, the whole thing is that we obviously we have bit like the similar age. So a lot of the music that we listened to when we grew up is quite similar. And there's, of course, some stuff of the early 80s, the new wave. Also, when we got socialized with electronic, with dance music in the early 90s, that's the same. But what was very important for us is that the production, of course, isn't retro. We didn't want to do a retro album. So it should sound like 2017 or, you know, very modern. But it obviously has these influences, and we're happy with that. We always like that.
We go in our fourth decade now, music-wise. So we work together since 33 years now, which is a long time. So we have a lot of influences, and we've heard a lot of music. And of course, we are kids of the 80s, but we also, we saw the techno coming, the techno train, and then the early 2000s, and the computer technology changed. So we have a lot of influences, you know. So I think this all is melting together. You can't really avoid it. So, but I think it's not like a retro album. It's definitely not. It's quite. It's really nice that you hold the microphone.
I thought about that myself. I was thinking about.
I can sit cooler.
Like slowly move it away. From
you. Just as you speak.
Yeah, as you speak.
So when did you two guys first meet then, and how?
We two.
Yeah.
That was we actually met in a school band, very, very old-fashioned. I moved from the place where I used to live in Dortmund to the southwest of Germany, where he lived. It's called it's close to a town called Saarbrücken. And my parents thought that it would be a nice thing to get to know other kids, to be in a school band, because I played the drums at that time already.
And then he gave me money that I talked to you.
I bought him an ice cream. I bought him some ice cream. So that's where we... If I'm happy with you...
Actually, it was a gray day, not a funny sunny day.
So we started the school band, and then... Like it is, there are always different people in the school band. People come and go, but we realized that because we were always there and we were very interested in music, and we realized that we wanted to do something with music. We had this, you know, crazy idea, because in those days it was hardly impossible to actually reach somebody at a record company. It was like in this big tower. This changed with techno big time. We know. Actually, the publisher that we work with here from Buddha UK, he used to work at a record label. I remember sending him demos back at that time, and it was absolutely impossible to reach somebody. And through techno and through the small labels that came up then, it was super liberating. And now actually we have the same thing with the internet and with Facebook, and you can reach people direct. You could even do it live. Oh, nobody got that. Okay. it's great.
You have to say that I've just listened to the really, really, really early demos, because I cleaned up my studio and I found these old cassettes and I listened to it. We sent the stuff that we sent to the record labels, and I have to say there is absolutely no talent on that cassette. It's proven, and we will never release it. So there's absolutely no. I played the music to my parents, and it's like
even they didn't like.
Yes. So they should have grabbed the keyboard away and said, do something else. But this is not your future. You know, it's not good. So probably that's why it was so hard for us to get through the A&Rs.
Yeah. No, but obviously you got better and better over the years, and this afternoon, well tonight, you've got a gig at Printworks in London, haven't you? Which you've got to go off and sound check for pretty soon. Are you excited about the gig and your forthcoming tour?
Craig, are you excited about it? Can I hand you over the microphone and you tell the people how excited you are?
I'm ecstatic. we've done three gigs now together. Last night was Berlin, which was great. The night before was Amsterdam, which was not as great. And the Brussels show was really not great. But we're getting better. There's progression.
What was wrong with those gigs then?
You say it's just three shows to go.
And what happened in Amsterdam anyway? I want to know.
You said just three shows. What about the Scandinavia tour we planned together? It's off?
We all got things.
It's off the...
We have
I'm confused.
Amsterdam. Printworks tonight. You
Printworks, yeah, we can't wait. We're really, really excited.
I think you're the first live band to play at Printworks, I believe.
Yeah, it's a great honor, yeah. Yeah, totally.
Did you know? No, because up to now it's a new venue. Everybody raves about it. We hear great things. Obviously, we haven't been there.
Looks good on the photos.
And up to now it was always the Saturdays, I was told, which are the clubbing days, nights, evenings, and today is the first Friday that they do the concerts. As many times with the guinea pigs, they throw in and see, a live show. Okay, let's try it. Let's see how it works. It's good. The ticket sales are great, so we're looking forward to it. It should be a good night, and it's very different, because the last time we were here, it was only in November. We played the Royal Festival Hall, so very different setting, very cultural, and this now is more like the warehouse style. So it's going to be interesting.
And with Craig, has it felt like you've had vocalists who've guested on various tracks, but has it felt like, why haven't you had an almost permanent vocalist in your live setup all the time?
Yeah, well, it's for a long time we felt it was instrumental music was good. That's why we did it. The no, but we felt for quite a while that it would be great to have a singer on stage. And not only does Craig sing, he also plays the bass. So and that's a great addition for those some of the classic songs that we play. So he adds the bass, and it all of a sudden feels very different, and it has more of the band appeal, and that's what we were looking for. So there's a certain, you know, with the arrangements, a certain roughness in it, and it's a lot of fun. So yeah, as you said, we only played three shows, so it has to, you know, blend, gel a bit more, but we already have the feeling what it can be like.
And you're not only going to play just the new album, are you?
Playing a lot of their hits.
Has anyone from the audience here got a question for the guys? Adam.
You at the back, you at the back. Yeah, so obviously you're known as a live act. So can you talk us through, obviously you've always played drums and live synths, and with the how is that different now for the print works and the tour you're doing at the moment?
It's not so different. It's the concept is the same since we started to do music together. So he has a huge drum set, and I have keyboards and vocoder. I sing much more than in the past, definitely, yeah, because I do the second, the harmony voices. To
on almost everything.
On almost everything, yeah. So that's probably the main difference, probably. So yeah, and then, as Arno said, Craig is on bass, and he sings, and... that's mainly it. Yeah. Some effects. Yeah.
Simple as that. Yeah. Straightforward.
Yeah.
Does anyone else have a question? Well, if not, we're gonna leave it then. We're gonna play the album, have an album listening session in here now, which is great for the privileged few here. The rest of the world are gonna have to go and buy it. When does it come out?
Today.
Today?
I think it's today.
Yeah. It is today, actually. Yeah. Yeah, it's today's day, yeah.
So download it right now.
Question is, do we have time for the dance routines?
I think that will have to be off camera.
I have problems with my back, but I'm... So the salto is probably not as good as it was with 25, but I try my best. No, okay, so that's...
We do a cappella version.
And what label's the album coming out on?
It's a great label.
Yeah, you said... You
great label. It's a great label. It's called Blaufield, and it's our label.
So, well, thanks very much for coming down, and good luck with your show tonight at the Printworks and the rest of the tour and everything else.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.